Good morning and welcome to the second meeting of the Welfare Reform Committee for 2016. Can I ask that everyone has their mobile phones and other electronic devices switched to silent and airplane mode? Thank you. We have apologies today from Joan McAlpine, who's had to attend a funeral. Item one, can we agree to take item three in private? Thank you. Item two on the agenda is the first evidence session on the Welfare Funds Scotland regulations of 2016. And can I welcome to the committee our witnesses, Bill Scott, who's the Director of Policy at Inclusion Scotland, John Shaw, the Welfare Rights Worker at the Child Poverty Action Group in Scotland, Jacqui, Kopel, the Senior Council Tax and Benefits Manager, Dundee City Council, Councillor Norman MacDonald, who's the Convener of Western Isles. I won't even attempt to offend you with my non-existent Gaelic pronunciation. Jules Oldham, who's the National Policy and Practice Coordinator, Homeless Action Scotland. Morag Johnston, the Assistant Director of Financial Services, Glasgow City Council. Carly Edgar, the Policy Manager, Who Cares Scotland, and Jamie Stewart, Housing Development Officer, the Scottish Refugee Council. Welcome to the committee, and thank you to those of you who have submitted written evidence. It's, you know, it is quite comprehensive and it covers a range of points, and we do appreciate you taking the time to do that. Could I just clarify something with the representatives from Dundee and Glasgow? Any views that you express here today, do they represent the administration, or are you here in a personal capacity?
Evidence that I did put in, we sent to our elected members, and they agreed my written evidence, but it's in an officer's capacity that I'm here.
Representative of Glasgow City Council, so any views that I expressed would be of Glasgow City Council.
Right, okay, thank you. A number of comments were made about, you know, different aspects of the regulations. For example, Jacqui, you suggested in your written submission that I think there should be a degree of flexibility, and I think others have kind of hinted at that as well, that there shouldn't be rigidity. Is there a problem in that if we introduced a significant degree of flexibility, you could end up with a postcode lottery across Scotland?
I think from my opinion and my experience within Dundee City Council, what we would welcome is discretion, so that the decision makers have the ability to meet the needs of the individuals who present within Dundee. What we would want, we welcome the legislation because it does give us guidelines, stricter guidelines to work around rather than just guidance. So everybody within Scotland is working to that same legislation. But we would like that still flexibility to meet individual needs, because within every individual area within Scotland, there's different people will present to the Scottish Welfare Fund. So that's why we would welcome some sort of discretion.
But how do you then ensure, for example, that someone with a specific set of circumstances in Perth would be receiving the same support as in Dundee? And similarly, how do you then control the budget? If you allowed 32 variations, but the financial support was coming from the Scottish Government, and the Scottish Government is having to control its budget, if Dundee, for argument's sake, or Glasgow, or Renfrewshire, or any other authority decided to exercise a significant degree of flexibility, how is that contained or constrained?
I mean, we're not asking for, you know, total discretion to, and, you know, carte blanche to pay whoever we want or to award to whoever we want to. If there's basic legislation there and guidelines that still gives us the discretion to help those in need, that's what we would be looking for within the legislation and the guidelines. If there are some restrictions or some examples or areas that of particular individuals that you would want to help, then that obviously helps all the decision makers.
Okay, anyone else? Sorry, Morag and then Carly.
Thank you. I think just it is a difficult balance. I think that has to be recognised between allowing flexibility for decision makers versus ensuring that there isn't that potential postcode lottery. I think certainly in Glasgow's experience since the inception of the interim scheme, we've found the guidance that was offered, and I think certainly our view is the proposed guidance going forward does continue to give us that flexibility. I think what has worked very well for the Scottish Welfare Fund has been quite an active practitioners group, which I understand all 32 local authorities across Scotland have worked with Scottish Government officials. And I think through that group, that is one of the ways that as local authorities we have tried to ensure that there is as much consistency as possible. And I would hope that that will continue in the formal scheme.
Okay, sorry, Carly.
It was just to add in, I think also if we are in agreement that the Welfare Fund is not just looking at potentially financial implications, but also about the potential for signposting an individual to additional support once the crisis has potentially been addressed. I think we have to take account of the fact that a crisis situation isn't necessarily a predictable one. They're not necessarily manageable, and that there may be circumstances where those assessing the applications need to have a degree of flexibility to account for an individual circumstance. And again, that may be less about financial support, and it might be about directing that individual onto the right kinds of support that can help them in the longer term. We know that for care experienced young people, that stable and supportive relationships are one of the key things for helping them navigate through care and beyond. And under the Children and Young People Act, looked after young people are now entitled to receive aftercare support until 26. If those assessing applications through the Welfare Fund were aware of that, they would be then able to signpost that person onto relationships that currently exist or potentially could exist in the future as well.
Okay. Norman?
I certainly think, from our point of view, we welcome the flexibility and the discretion that is within the regulations. I think there are additional flexibilities there that I recall that we were asking for a year and a half ago when I was at the committee last, which is to do with single people. And I think in terms of postcode lottery, in our geography is such that most of our population is centred around the main population centre, and there will inevitably be differences. And it's exactly that flexibility and discretion that's given to the local authority that allows us to meet the needs of the individuals wherever they are within the Western Isles. And there will no doubt be variations across Scotland too. And I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing, because with that flexibility goes the accountability, and I think that's what Morag was speaking of in terms of the professionals who are involved, along with third sector colleagues who are also employed by their organisations to work on behalf of the people in their community whose interests they represent. I think that there is sufficient there to make sure that there is the consistency, again, that Morag spoke of, although there is a significant amount of flexibility. I think it would be really difficult to deliver if it was a rigid structure. And the principles, I think, are right, as far as our community are concerned.
Okay, thank you. Jules?
I think it's important to remember as well, it's not a huge amount of money, but the difference it makes is massive. And certainly in relation to the community care grant element, that really works towards tenancy sustainment. Now, the most recent kind of work we did around tenancy sustainment from 2011, if a tenancy fails, you're looking at £15,000 to £25,000 cost overall. So to actually have the outlay to ensure somebody's got a bed, carpets, cooker, you know, the very basics we're talking about, but if somebody's got those to start a tenancy, then actually there's the chance of them succeeding and having a successful tenancy is far greater for a really small amount, kind of in relation to the possible sort of failure at the end of that.
Okay, thanks. Carly, you mentioned crisis situations, and I think Bill Inclusion Scotland in the written evidence had indicated you had a concern about the limit in the number of crisis grants that could be paid. I think it was you didn't want it restricted to three. Is there a danger that if you lift a restriction, that the crisis grant could in fact become a de facto weekly payment?
I think we're coming back to discretion. What we're pointing out is in our written evidence was that some people are more likely to be in crisis situations more often than others. So disabled women are more likely to be sexually abused, more likely to suffer domestic violence, and more likely to suffer financial abuse than other women. And if they only got two payments for the crisis grants, but then they actually chose to leave their abusive partner, and they needed that to get by for a week, we don't think that you should be putting an arbitrary limit on that. We think you should be using your discretion to say, actually, we want to give you that fresh start. You know, so a community care grant might also be payable. But you know, we recognise that some people are in more crisis situations than others, and therefore, you know, we want that flexibility built in. We don't think, using that discretion, that you're going to make multiple payments without thinking about it. I know you're not, but we would like to see a situation where if you thought that person really, really needs that payment to get by, and it's the fourth payment, why shouldn't we pay it? Rather than being completely inflexible and saying, we don't care what's happened to you, we're not going to intervene to support you in this situation. So, you know, in some ways, we do want that flexibility and discretion built in, but within a national framework, the legislation, regulations and guidance that guides people to come to, we hope, you know, decisions that respect the applicant's humanity, you know, upholds their dignity and respect, etc. So, as I say, not arguing that you can have unlimited numbers of payments, but just not an arbitrary limit. You know, that doesn't work for us, you know, very well.
But how would you stop unlimited payments then if you don't set a number? You're saying you don't want an arbitrary target, but there would be nothing, you know, supposing a family was in a complete crisis and destitute, then local decision makers, could they not then decide that for 10, 15, 20 weeks, such a payment would be justified?
I think the situation you're describing is one of destitution, and you know, I would hope that as a society we would respond to that better than crisis payments alone. But I think that is the same crisis continuing, and it's a different situation from a number of different crises that the individual could face. And what you're doing is trying to judge, okay, are we going to refuse a payment simply because this is the fourth crisis that's occurred, you know, in that family, rather than exercising your discretion to say, actually, this is a different situation. We do think you need the help at this time, and we're going to intervene and provide it, rather than, I think, as the situation you've described, is one where there's an ongoing crisis that's just not being resolved. And that's the sort of situation where I would hope there would have already been a referral from the team, you know, making those decisions to say, actually, this family's in an ongoing crisis. Social work needs to intervene. Housing needs to intervene. We need to have a solution to their problems that actually lifts them out of the crisis rather than allowing it to continue for 12 weeks, you know, 6 months, whatever. Otherwise, you know, you'll never resolve it. And it's not about crisis payments then, it's about a much higher level of intervention than you're getting from a crisis payment.
And, you know, if in a local situation a decision is made to have repeated payments made. Should the funding of that come from Scottish Government, or should it come from the Council's resources if they decide to use that flexibility? Because I can't remember who it was. One of the written submissions suggested that using payments in that way could actually help to obviate more significant expenditure from social work and other agencies. I don't know, was it CPAG?
It was ours, yes. I think it was part of the point that we were making about the need to, picking up on Bill's point about onward referrals, we thought that a better way of preventing repeated crisis grant applications is actually for local authorities to record who they're referring people to, what, and then we can start to see what's underlying those crises, or as Bill says, that one underlying crisis, because no one wants to see a situation where somebody has not claimed a social security benefit they'd be entitled to because they're simply not aware of their entitlement and they're repeatedly applying for crisis grants. And I think our evidence made clear it's far from inevitable that everybody with mental health problems who's refused a crisis grant will end up as a psychiatric hospital admission, but it's starting to move towards that early intervention approach of using the Scottish Welfare Fund to reduce pressure on the rest of the system. And I think that is a difficult question in terms of whether local authorities should be able to come back to the Scottish Government and request.
Yeah, but I come back to the question then, if local authorities decide to use that discretion extensively, who should fund it, given that such payments may obviate further expenditure for councils? Should the councils fund that out of their resources, or should the Scottish Government fund it?
I'm not sure we've really come to a position on who should be funding that. I think we look at it from the point of view of the applicant needing that assistance, and reducing it to a competition between the different budgets is a difficult one.
Norman and then Bill.
Thank you, Cornel. I think the amount of funds that are available through the Scottish Welfare Fund are not going to deal with multiple awards to people right across the country. I think it's for a very specific need. And I think for the amount of money that's there, the number of people that have benefited from it and haven't required multiple assistances shows that it works at that level. And I think we are talking about a completely different level if we're going back to the same clients. The very first thing our team do when they engage with individuals is there is an automatic referral, whether it's to Citizens by Scotland or whoever, to make sure that they are getting all the assistance that they're entitled to. And very often that tends to bring in more money than they get through the crisis grant or the community grant. So there is a significant amount of work that goes on, and it's not just about money. It could be about goods, it could be about other kinds of assistance as well, and it's about making sure that package is right. And the better the package is, the better the chances are that you're not going to have multiple referrals to the same individuals again and again. And I think our officers are quite mindful of that when they're dealing with multiple referrals. It's not an easy route for anybody to be on, to be using this kind of resource to deal with much more deep-seated issues for these individuals who are concerned and their families as well.
Okay, Bill?
I think one of the things is that we need to see what the actual level we need is. And in some ways, if we discourage people from applying because they've reached an arbitrary limit, we're not seeing what the real need is. And even if you are going to refuse on various grounds any further payments, I wouldn't discourage the person from coming forward, because at the end of the day, Scottish Government and the local authorities need to know what the actual level of need is in their area. Now, that's arguing that if we find out that there are significantly more applications turned down because they've reached a limit, or it's the same crisis rather than a new crisis that's arisen, then we can go back to Scottish Government and say, you know, the local authorities can go back and say, well, actually, the amount we are being funded to provide this service isn't adequate because we're having to turn down people in real need, genuine need. Now, it cannot be that the Scottish Welfare Fund acts as a replacement for other social security benefits. That isn't its intent, and we get that. It is cash limited and budget limited to that extent. But I do also think you do need to get a real picture of how much unmet need there is, so that you can make sure that adequate funds are set aside to meet that need, to meet that crisis need that exists. And you'll, that means actually actively encouraging people to come forward and make applications, rather than saying, you've reached your three, you can't get another one. We would argue that, you know, we need to encourage applications to identify unmet need.
I know, John, you're wanting to come in, but I'll take Morag and then Jules, and then we'll bring you in.
Thank you, Chair. I suppose this is an area where we've probably had some examples over the last 18 months because of the increasing impact of sanctions. And again, when that increase in sanctions being applied by the DWP, and I think, again, practitioners very quickly realised that the Scottish Welfare Fund was going to be a source of requests for individuals affected. And I think the way that local authorities have tried to deal with that is, as explained, that something like that is a recurring crisis for an individual, but the Scottish Welfare Fund wasn't set up to deal with that long term. And I think that's where it is important that local authorities do have to try and put in place some other kind of mechanism to try and deal with the source of the issue, rather than just simply dealing with the results of the issue. You know, so in our local authority, we have tried to encourage people who present us through the Scottish Welfare Fund because of a sanction. We will provide support to them as far as we can financially, but we will then offer support to them to whether they want to challenge the sanction with the DWP, and then obviously offer them additional welfare rights support. And I think that's where, you know, local authorities should be in those types of circumstances.
Okay, Jules.
Just to highlight that for the vast majority, it's not easy to ask for help. And so, you know, yes, there will be the minority that will be seen time and time again. But actually, even with that minority, then you've got a point to see if we can get to the kind of real heart of an issue, which is possibly something else. But it's really difficult to actually ask for help, in particular financial help of some variety, to say I'm not coping. So I think we need to take that into consideration.
Okay, thank you. John?
Thank you, Convener. My question is about the cap and the possible removal of it, and I suppose it's really to the council reps who are here, and whether they anticipate, if the cap was removed, do you see a significantly higher caseload coming towards you? I mean, are you aware of people who get to their three grants who would come back to you if the cap was removed?
I'll let the councils answer that, and then I know Neil wants to come in.
Yes, I mean, there is a small minority of individuals who will come back time and time again because they find themselves in crisis, and it could be, as someone's already mentioned, that it's actually the same crisis, it's not a different crisis, it's because it's a consequence of something else that's happened in their life, whether it be with tax credits or whatever, but it is the same crisis, and like Glasgow City Council, we will always try and offer further support. But I think in answer to your question, that there will be a small minority that will continue to come back. But I don't see the majority of the individuals that we have coming to us will be ones that will continually come back three or four times.
Morag?
I think certainly our view is that I think it's helpful to have a cap in terms of setting that expectation and setting the policy intention of the fund. However, I think the ability, again, in exceptional circumstances, for local authorities to exceed that cap is something that we could work with. I think to remove the cap completely could potentially send out maybe a message that the fund is there for something broader than it should be. So I think certainly in our consultation response, we did say that, you know, we're happy to support the cap, but we would like the ability in exceptional circumstances if the decision maker felt that was appropriate.
Okay, Norman.
I think Morag made the point I was going to make about the exceptional circumstances and giving that discretion to local authorities, knowing fine well that ultimately they are the ones who are going to have to have a large part in dealing with whatever the issue is that causes people to come back again and again. They will have a huge amount of responsibility, either through assistance of this kind or through social work services or through education or whatever other service. And very often, exercising that discretion will be about making a decision as to what happens if we don't award the grant. What could the implications be for the individual, first and foremost, but also in terms of the service being provided to others in the community. And I think that's an important part, you know, to weigh up in terms of exercising that discretion. And I think it is something that I think we can be confident that our officers who are working with that will bear that in mind, you know, as they're working through that process. But I think it is important to have that discretion. Otherwise, it'll become quite difficult to persuade people to come forward, as Jules was saying, and come forward in a way that we can help them through the crisis, whatever issues they're facing.
Okay, thanks. Jamie?
Yeah, just on the point of sort of exceptionality, in our written evidence, we've sort of suggested that the Act already allows for, it sort of specifies that a crisis grant is only for a sort of short-term need according to exceptional circumstances, and that we've argued that the guidance on what short-term need and exceptional circumstances would be properly placing in guidance rather than an arbitrary limit in regulations, which sort of suggests a certain amount. I see the point around the policy intention, but this should maybe properly be left in guidance rather than in regulation. You know, particular examples of when what amounts to exceptional circumstances, what amounts to a short-term need, that would be the best place for it.
Okay, Carly.
My point was much the same as just been stated there. We are fully supportive of the intention not to encourage over-reliance on crisis grants. That's not going to solve any issues that individuals face. However, again, we are concerned that strict limitation would mean that genuine need is not appropriately addressed. I think in terms of relying on exceptional circumstances, we would be really concerned that that to do that without further clarification about what exceptional circumstances might include will mean that we're solely relying on the professional judgment of those that are assessing the applications, which I think is appropriate, but only if adequate training and adequate guidance is given to that individual to understand the types of situations of those key groups who are likely to apply for crisis grants in the first place. I think we know that care leavers are likely to leave care far too early and without the appropriate preparation to manage with independent living. And I think understanding the reality of what that looks like for many young people who are trying to navigate their way through paying bills and just managing their own house would help give some certain context to the individual making the application decision.
Okay, Neil?
If there's reporting mechanisms for the welfare fund and, you know, how many people across Scotland have been awarded grants and how many have been refused? Does anybody know that figure?
Morag?
It's something that we record, obviously, within our own council in terms of the number of applications and the numbers that we award and the numbers that we decline.
Is it nationally reported?
My understanding is it is nationally reported, yes, and the statistics. It's part of the submission.
I didn't find that in the submission. Maybe it's just I've not looked hard enough. But
well, we could ask either Spice or Scottish Government if the figures are available.
Okay. Yeah. In terms of how it actually operates, is there a case management system? So, for example, if I phoned in and was awarded grant, is that then allocated to a particular council official to follow that through, do the referral, follow the referral up, all of that type of thing, or is it a case of do we send the money and kind of send a referral and that's it?
Morag?
Yeah. I think certainly if you're speaking for a crisis grant perspective, very often it can be just simply that the money is paid and there may not be any onward referral. It would really be for the decision maker, as you know, in terms of understanding the individual circumstances, to determine if that particular crisis required an onward referral. But certainly within our own council, we don't have details of all the onward referrals. We don't keep that as a matter, of course.
And the, I think it was the Refugee Council's submission, they said the average award was 108 for men and 216 for women who are, I think that's people waiting on benefit delays. Would that be the average across the board? Do we know the figure?
Okay.
And from a crisis grant perspective, our average award is round about the £100 mark, but my understanding is I think Glasgow's probably on the high side. So those figures, certainly the £200 mark for a crisis grant, do seem a little high. Again, I understand that's information that is gathered centrally, so should be available to the committee.
Okay, we'll get that. Do the councils work to a monthly budget or a weekly budget or an annual budget, and once the budget's gone, is that it? Or is there a, you know, so do you work, and is there an instruction goes out to staff to say, you know, we're only 2 weeks into this month and the money's almost gone and there's no more this month, or how does that practically operate?
Budget on a monthly basis, but now that we're 2 years into the scheme, we do have, you know, trends and months that we know that are busier than others. The manager of the service will look at the demand throughout that month, and you know, we work on a priority basis. Like currently, we're just working on high priority cases, but the budget is profiled over a 12-month basis. But there will be months that we will overspend and months that we underspend.
Certainly our experience is very similar. We would profile the budget and we monitor it very closely so that we try and prevent, and so far we have prevented a situation where we've had to refuse all applications simply because we've run out of money. We try to very carefully manage it. The way we manage that is by deciding what priority level we are advising decision makers to consider. And so generally, you know, we would start off with only high priority applications would be considered. And if we felt that there was capacity, we have in the past moved to considering medium priority applications. And that's how we try and manage our money through the year. But we always certainly ensure that we spend every penny of allocation that we get, but we also avoid getting to a situation towards the end of the year that we have run out of money.
Yeah, just when... Sorry.
I was just going to agree that we would profile our budget over the year as well, but we also know there are peaks. A lot of our awards are in relation to fuel poverty. That's the main driver for them, and we have the highest levels of fuel poverty in the country. So we know that in the winter months we're likely to have a higher demand in terms of that. So we would profile our funding based on that. And again, I think that's evident in, you know, in the figures over the last 3 years, where certainly we saw a peak in the figures when it came to the bedroom tax and the aftermath of that. There was a peak in the figures then, but then seems to have settled down to the pattern we had just before that.
I think Jamie, and then I'll come back to Neil.
Yeah, just to go, the figures that we gave and the variation in the figures, which are sort of across the board, and that I think that probably goes to the individual circumstances of those people who are applying. That sort of reflects a sort of multi-dimensional nature of the need of all the groups which are applying, which I think sort of reinforces the point that arbitrary limits and arbitrary sort of limits are not necessarily best placed within regulation, that guidance is better shaped to take into account those multi-dimensional needs, the different reasons why people might want to make a claim and be awarded certain amounts of money. You know, for example, the typical refugee claim, which is upon receiving status, the asylum support drops away, and a claim for benefits is put in place. It takes quite some time to get that benefit into payment, mainly because of a lack of a national insurance number. So that may account for some of the sort of higher levels of claims for that particular group, and the current system being that we're allowed to make a claim for 14 days worth of money, that isn't that often isn't enough. Working with Glasgow City Council, we work around that by having a review of that award. So 14 days, if the benefits are not in place, we review, and then we review again. It's not really the best use of the review system for one thing, but there are what guidance we'd be able to do is take account of those situations, the situations of the clients of a number of the sort of third sector agencies around the table, and sort of allow for sort of that those circumstances, those different circumstances which happen to all of our clients.
Okay, Neil, briefly.
Yeah. Two final things. Just reflecting on what you said there, Morag, about you start off with high priority, and if there's cash in the system that goes down, I'm just wondering whether that's opening the system to real inconsistency, because somebody could apply at a time when the instruction has gone out to only high. Somebody applies maybe when there's a bit of slack in the system, and then they talk to each other and say, well, how did I not get it at that point? And I think there's maybe a danger of that. And the final point is in terms of unintended consequences. I've spoke to an organisation recently who were involved in a furniture recycling project for a long number of years, providing very high quality furniture to people who previously homeless or setting up home for the first time and all that kind of thing. When the welfare fund came on, that was then out to tender for new furniture. They did not win the tender. Another organisation did. And because the furniture provided through the welfare fund is new, that organisation's good work is now all gone, because the welfare fund gives people access to new furniture, not to the recycling project. So, I mean, it's not the biggest issue, but for that organisation it is, because they've been a very credible organisation in the community. So they're kind of feeling a bit out of the loop, if you like, having been involved in providing a really good service for a long number of years. I'm just wondering if that's happening elsewhere.
Anybody have any evidence? No?
Provide new furniture. We don't use reused furniture for any crisis community care grant applications we receive.
Yeah. A number of members who wish to come in. Kevin had indicated first, but Christine, I think, did you want to follow up on a specific point?
Absolutely, Convener. Thank you very much. And it's quite a quick point in the Refugee Council's submission. One of the issues that you raised is the impact of the new immigration bill and how that will then have an impact on some of the families that you support, with support not being given at crucial times, with the result that children could be left in destitution. Is that something? I know that the Refugee Council and Glasgow City Council worked very, very closely on this, but whether you could maybe give us a bit of insight into that and whether you're preparing for that eventuality.
Well, we've responded to all of the UK government's consultations and all of and we've done a lot of work into opposing the new immigration bill in a number of different ways. It has a number of different impacts on our clients, to do with housing and also to do with the support that asylum seekers receive. What it does in sort of very short terms is it increases the possibility that it breaks the sort of automatic link between a refusal of someone's asylum claim and the immediate sort of transfer onto a sort of very basic support level on, say, Section 4 support. And We've done a lot of work into it. We're still working with a number of different partners to try and sort of stop the most egregious parts of that bill coming through. In terms of the work that we're doing, we've got a destitution project that's ongoing, and we're still working on destitution. And whenever we possibly can, we try and alleviate destitution and work on those things. What we're seeing within our submission is that destitution is a real problem. It's a destitution of asylum seekers is a real problem. It's difficult to sort of quantify in any great detail, but we've had hundreds of clients come through our door since our destitution project started. So what there's nothing within the Immigration Acts which prevents the Scottish Welfare Fund from paying to a destitute asylum seeker. It is currently within one of the exceptions, and there's a similar fund which the Northern Irish Government is using for destitute asylum seekers, and it's important to point out that not all destitute asylum seekers will fall within the definition of someone with short-term need arising from exceptional circumstances, but some will. Some will perhaps if their claim is going back into the system, and that there is a short-term administrative problem. And that does account for certainly a fair few people, and that would be an it would certainly be a beneficial use of the fund to try and alleviate or try and do some work towards alleviating destitution amongst asylum seekers.
Okay, thanks very much. Thank you.
Okay,
thanks, Kevin.
Thank you, Convener. During the course of the journey through this, these changes. Including the implementation of the interim scheme. It seems that there has been fairly good communication between those at the front line who are dealing with this and the government and civil servants to get this absolutely right. Now, we know that, you know, this is a sticking plaster, if you like, in terms of some of the absolutely awful changes that have taken place in the social security system. I think the key thing for me in dealing with this new piece of legislation regarding the regulations is I want to be absolutely certain that the common sense approach that is applied thus far, the listening approach that has taken place from government before, has happened again. And I would want to hear from those folks round the table, where are the flaws, if there are any in this? Does this still allow you the flexibility, using your knowledge at the front line, to allow grants to be made in exceptional circumstances where you and your teams deem them to be exceptional circumstances?
Morag?
I mean, certainly from Glasgow City Council's perspective, you know, we did make a submission to the original consultation, but any of the comments we made, I think it's fair to say, were on the margins because we accepted that the regulations and the guidance that accompanied that were broadly similar to what has operated within the interim scheme. And in terms of your question about where are the flaws, I don't think there's anything I would particularly highlight from a delivery perspective that we think will significantly change how we operate the scheme just now. And obviously we will, you know, continue to have that dialogue both with local government colleagues to try and ensure a consistency with other organisations and with the Scottish Government, I think, to continue the work, the good work that has been done since the interim scheme was introduced.
Thank you, Convener. Again, I would agree with that from our point of view. Our team has done an assessment on the awards that have been given over the piece, and none of them would have had any difficulties in terms of the new regulations, you know, in terms of being able to have made these awards. I think the concern we would have in terms of flexibility that Mr. Stewart's talking about is to have that discretion and flexibility and not have arbitrary levels set, either in terms of the number of grants that can be awarded or some definition of what low income is, because again, that is relative to where you live. I would imagine that our average income in the Hebrides is much less than just about any other local authority in Scotland in terms of the average incomes. So I think having these arbitrary levels set would actually make it difficult for our officers to deal with some of the cases that they're coming across. And I think the flexibility that is there, we're very supportive of the approach that has been taken with regulations. It is built on the evidence that has been gathered through the interim process, I think.
Okay, Bill?
Yeah, it's really just to echo what Kevin has said about the willingness of Scottish Government officials and the practitioners group from local authorities to work with the third sector and thereby with users of the service to actually improve, to identify best practice, to identify barriers that could exist and to try and address those barriers. That's been an ongoing process throughout the interim scheme and has continued through trying to work on the regulations that have emerged, and we've been, you know, quite pleased at the willingness of both officials and practitioners to learn and to listen to the experience of the users, and ourselves and People First, who a learning disabled group, and British Deaf Association have actually provided training to practitioners on some of the barriers that disabled people face in accessing the Scottish Welfare Fund. And again, we were very, very open to learning and you know, addressing those barriers. So it's been very good. One thing I'd like to return to and what Neil raised about the figures, I think it's really important. The figures are produced quarterly. Every local authority does or should do a return to Scottish Government identifying you know, applications made, applications awarded, and percentage of budget spent. And I think that should continue with the new system so that councils continue to be accountable to you know, both the users and wider society. And we wouldn't like to see that dropped, because it is a level of scrutiny that really needs to continue to be able to identify, you know, if there are any difficulties with some authorities in actually using the budget that they've been given by Scottish Government. We know there are some authorities that spend to budget and over it, but there are other authorities that don't use all of the resources that are being given to them. And we don't think, we'd agree with, you know, Western Isles, need does vary between areas, but we're absolutely certain that there's poverty throughout Scotland, and, you know, that the resources there really do need to be used to address that.
Okay, Carly.
Just wanted to agree with the points that have been raised. The level of engagement with key groups throughout this process has been really commendable from both the committee and the Scottish Government team. Like Bill stated, training of some of the potential assessors has involved care experienced young people as well and potential case studies. We would hope that going forward, that level of attention to detail on the training of individuals will continue in some level. I think that some of the potential issues that could still arise, as I've mentioned already, understanding about the types of context that these key groups that we are representing around this table are likely to experience are going to be essential for potential assessors of the applications to understand clearly. And not just that, but also a recognition of the fact that, for example, for care experienced young people, there's still a massive issue of stigma that they feel that they hold. We see this across our communities when local communities are campaigning to have children's houses built within their area, because there's still a perception that being in care is associated with bad behaviour rather than the reality of facing neglect or that your family can or won't look after you. I think for young people that are in care who witness that, the feeling that that can then give to you, that you have to then hide your care identity, and that potentially when you are trying to access funds that you might not disclose the fact that you've been in care, can actually be to the detriment of that individual who makes the application. And I think we have to be extremely clear with our young people that this is an entitlement of theirs. They have the right to apply, and that we need to make sure that they are informed of that.
Okay, thanks.
Convener, obviously in some areas the level of training that has been taking place is huge. The level of cooperation between various agencies is probably greater than I've ever seen. In the northeast of Scotland, the group of practitioners who and third sector organisations who are looking at all of the impacts of these social security changes, the work that they've done is immense. Now, I think we've heard from others before that maybe one of the areas where we do fall down is in terms of dealing with care leavers. And really, in some regards, that should be one of the areas where practitioners are well aware because of corporate parenting responsibilities. Why is it that we're not necessarily getting that right then?
I think that... Well, I think we know that care leavers have faced some of the worst outcomes potentially, with only 6% likely to go on to higher education after school, yet making up 30% of homeless populations and 50% of the prison population. And actually, our advocacy experience tells us that these stats probably don't even tell the truth, because they don't pick up on hidden homeless populations, and also prisons might rely on self-identification of care. So I think first and foremost, there's a lack of understanding and a lack of recognition about the difficulties that a young person faces when they leave care. An individual's care journey can be blighted by instability, by care placement breakdown. We accept that. However, it seems to be that when an individual chooses to leave care or leaves care too early and without the preparation for them to then go on and manage independent living, that our tolerance levels across the public tend to be lower, or we think that there are other avenues of support that might be there. And I think with the corporate parenting legislation, we have a real opportunity now to make sure that local authorities and other corporate parents are working together to make sure that they're providing the right supports for our care leavers. I think if we think about the Children and Young People Act broadly, being able to access aftercare support until 26 is huge. But unless the local authorities who are the individuals who are involved in assessing the applications are aware of that, then we're going to continually fail to identify and signpost these young people back to the kinds of relationships and support that they need to actually progress in life.
So that's maybe something that needs to be brought up at the practitioners group, so that all local authorities are aware of those responsibilities. Yeah. I don't want to dwell on this too much, Convener, but I just wonder...
Well, hold on, Kevin, because John wanted to come in.
I think we should know from local authorities if folk get training around about corporate...
Yeah, we'll come back to that in a minute, but John wanted to come in.
This was in response to your initial point about the engagement, and we wouldn't disagree. You know, the Scottish Government civil servants have done an excellent job with engaging practitioners and third sector. But specifically when we're thinking about these regulations, I think there is a tension there, and it comes back to that point about the flexibility versus the consistency. And I think Regulation 7 of what we've got here is a good example of that, because it sets out the procedure for applications. And this would be, for us, the place where you should be setting out exactly what people should be able to expect across Scotland in terms of the way in which they can access the fund. But all Regulation 7 actually says is that a procedure must be established and put on a local authority's website. And, you know, we're not suggesting for a second that there shouldn't be the discretion to make an exception where somebody's already had 3 crisis grants this year. But to us, that seems to be an example of where there's too much flexibility, because it's not about who can get a grant, it's about the ways in which grants are made accessible. And as pressure on the fund increases in the longer term, local authorities, of course, are going to have to make tough decisions. And it will be places like this where the regulations simply don't say what's necessary, how many application channels you have to provide. So in terms of our view of the balance of flexibility versus consistency across Scotland, I think that's one area among several which are in our written evidence submission where we think that perhaps there should be more consistency put within the regulations, and the guidance does build on that to a degree by suggesting that local authorities should have multiple application channels, but that would seem to be quite clearly something should be on the face of the regulations to us.
Okay, Kevin, do you want to come back to the training issue?
It is the training issue round about corporate parenting, because obviously it does seem to be an area where there is some misunderstanding sometimes, shall we put it that way. Can I ask if those folks in the front line get training about corporate parenting responsibilities? Morag?
Chair, I'm not able to confirm or not whether that is the case. What I would say is that certainly the guidance does talk about our role as corporate parents, so that's something that's been very explicitly pulled out. We also, as a council, work very closely with our social work services colleagues as well, you know, and certainly possibly not through crisis grants, but through the community care grants. I would imagine we are certainly supporting care leavers, but it's certainly something I'll take back to the council and follow up on.
Okay, Norman.
Certainly as a local, as a member, we were given corporate parenting training, and the people who were involved in the delivery of it were some of the folk are in the revenue and benefits section. They were involved in it, as well as other people through social work and our legal department, in terms of the training they provided to us. So for them to be able to do that, they themselves must have had some corporate parenting training as well. And I think it is really important to have that understanding of the responsibility. And if we can come back maybe to a point, you know, in terms of the flexibility versus consistency, I think what there has to be is consistency of approach, that the approach is the same throughout the country in terms of the way we deal with it. But I think if we try and define that consistency to the nth degree, then we will be setting arbitrary levels, and that will become an issue for us. And I think the consistency of approach is something that is important. And with the flexibility goes accountability. I mean, we have reports coming every quarter. The reports that are prepared for going to Scottish Government are presented to members at the Policy and Resources Committee on a quarterly basis. And that is where we, although it isn't per se our money that is providing this service, the Scottish Government funding is doing. But we are accountable in the same sense as our officers are. And we take that responsibility quite seriously in terms of that, because ultimately we have had, in the past, we had times where there wasn't sufficient funding in any one year, and we committed some of our reserves to that rather than stop giving awarding the grants. Now, that's not something that we're going to be able or prepared to do on an ongoing basis. But again, that is something that, as an authority, we recognise that we have to have some flexibility in terms of the way we deal with it too.
Okay, Jacqui.
Yeah, back to the corporate parenting. It's probably an area that our decision makers need further information on, although they are aware of it because it is in the guidance. But as Carly mentioned, unless that individual tells us in application form that they are leaving a care situation, then our decision makers really won't have any way of knowing. So it's about getting the right information on the application form or from the applicant at the time of submission, so that we have enough information to make the correct decision.
Okay, Carly.
I just want to agree with the points. I think it's really promising to see that the corporate parenting legislation has been included within the guidance. That's really encouraging. We as an organisation do deliver corporate parenting training to all corporate parents, and we have a team dedicated to focusing on that as it stands just now. That training would tell the corporate parents about the live experiences of care experienced young people in terms of working alongside the corporate parents, and it would definitely be something that I would encourage all to pursue. I think in a addition to that, I've just lost my point. I think that also, the other point I was going to make was in relating to informing care leavers that they should be identifying with yourselves that they have a care experience. Within the regulations, it talks about the local authority informing people via their website about the types of methods that they are going to adopt for their application process. One of our suggestions would be that the Welfare Fund Act has identified key groups who are likely to apply for assistance, and care leavers are one of them. We think that local authorities should be attempting to target specific groups, for example, focusing on leave and care services or local care placements prior to a young person leaving care, so that they're equipped with information about what they're entitled to, and they know how to ask for it and what kind of information to give as a kind of more proactive method.
Okay, Claire.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to go back to quite a while ago now, Mr. Stewart's comments. I know in your written submission you've given quite detailed timescales about delays and benefits, such as 46 days for child benefits, 77 days for child tax credits, but you mentioned the problem with the DWP and maintaining national insurance numbers. Now, when we were doing our previous report on women in welfare, it was a theme that came through. And something that was particularly highlighted was the difficulty for refugee women who were fleeing domestic abuse as well, and the problems. So I just really want to get a bit more information about what the scale of the DWP problems are, and the length of time it's taken, and whether there's any sort of explanation as to why it takes so long for this to happen.
I mean, the issue of benefit delay amongst new refugees is something which is far from new. It's something that we've been trying to get a handle on for some time. The way that it should work is that national insurance numbers should be requested by the Home Office upon someone being granted status. The DWP should then be looking to get someone in for a national insurance number interview as soon as possible, and then it kind of should follow on from there. And through the new Scots Refugee Integration Strategy, which the Scottish Government has been doing in partnership with ourselves for the last coming up for 2 years now, we've been trying to get to the bottom of those delays. It has been quite difficult. There's no instant kind of solution to those delays in getting national insurance numbers in place. So it's certainly the case that this is a system which could be well improved for between the DWP and the Home Office. In fact, I could probably say that about most of the benefit delays that happen generally. I think the Scottish Government, along with all levels of government, have got a key role in trying to tighten that up, trying to ensure that the Scottish Welfare Fund isn't a sticking plaster on a broken system, which at times it does appear that is the case. Until that, so I think using the information which comes from the Scottish Welfare Fund, why applications are being made, by whom, gathering information on the types of groups who are making the claims. So I think currently we don't have a way of tracking refugee claims, for example. I know I've had some discussions with Glasgow about how we can better track that, to use that information to try and mend the system and try and reduce that pressure which shouldn't necessarily be there. But as we stand, we are looking at the delays that are set out in written evidence, you're looking at that sort of 42 days for job seekers allowance, but then longer for other benefits. So the impact on, for example, women more likely to claim income support, children who wait the longest for their child benefit and child tax credit to come into payment. So in the meantime, until that system can be mended and to operate properly, there is a real role for the Scottish Welfare Fund, which is currently being in use and which we continue to work on.
Thank you.
John?
Just to pick up on the Jamie's point there as well, I think it's important that in that kind of situation, the Scottish Welfare Fund isn't an additional barrier. So one of the cases which we cited in our written evidence was of somebody who was refused a Scottish Welfare Fund grant because they didn't have a national insurance number. So there's nothing in the Act, draft regulations or guidance which would support that decision, and that is just one case. But I think it goes to the regulation on decisions on fund applications and the wide discretion given in terms of application required to make a decision on an application. So I think it's really important that decision makers are conscious of the fact that some people will, particularly refugees, asylum seekers, have no documentation and face real difficulty proving their identity to the satisfaction of DWP decision makers. And it's really important that the Scottish Welfare Fund doesn't then exacerbate that problem by imposing similar requirements.
Jamie earlier on talked about regulations and guidance, and I think, John, you also referred to some of the specific regulations. The way that the system works, or the procedure is, we can either accept the regulations or reject them. We can't change them in any way. And therefore, the question of guidance becomes, you know, of huge significance. So, you know, we've talked a lot about crisis grants and, you know, we've touched on one or two other things, but, you know, coming back to Bill's point, and I think this has been echoed not just at the meeting today, but, you know, over a long period of time, that there has been very positive cooperation between practitioners and the civil servants who are involved. So it would be useful for us to know, firstly, whether you're generally content with the regulations, and then secondly, what comments would you have about where the guidance can be improved or some changes to the guidance that you think would be beneficial. So firstly, are all of the witnesses generally supportive of the regulations being passed? Yeah. Don't think anyone would be opposed to that. What about guidance? Are there things that you think could be done in the guidance that would help? So, Carly, and then come back to John.
Just to echo a point that's already been made, actually, about the strict limitations. While there are the wording in the regulations does allow for professional judgment and exceptional circumstances to potentially come in to allow somebody to agree to an application, I think we're really going to be reliant on the guidance explaining what exceptional circumstances could potentially include. I would never suggest that the guidance should be too prescriptive in its method. However, I think it does help to potentially have some case study examples about the rarer circumstances that may occur and the types of individuals that are likely to apply to the fund.
Okay. John and Jules.
Yes, so absolutely better to have the Act and the regulations and not... one example we've talked about a lot is families under exceptional pressure. The regulations are drafted in the only way that really can be, given the content of the Act. But just thinking about the guidance specifically, I was having a look this morning at the guidance, which is still in draft form, obviously, but under Regulation 10, where it talks about the form of crisis grant assistance. And in these regulations, we have the thing about not forcing an applicant to make over the payment to a particular person in a particular way, and that doesn't apply if the local authority considers it would be advantage to the applicant for the crisis grant to be provided in a different manner. So a lot of people around the room commented on the importance of taking into account the views of the applicant. And just on that really specific point, the guidance actually suggests that a local authority must have evidence that it would be of advantage to the applicant for a crisis grant to be paid in a different manner to the default. And that's really interesting because the regulations don't say there has to be any evidence, just says that the local authority has to consider it. And I think it's really important that, particularly in these cases where the regulations have left almost total discretion to local authorities, that then the guidance really does build in things like the views of the applicant and is careful not to go beyond what's required by the regulations, because that's ultimately limiting the ability of the decision maker to exercise their discretion. Because if you look at your guidance and it says you must have evidence before you can consider an alternative form of crisis grant provision, then you're unlikely to look back at the regulations, which make no such requirement on local authority decision makers. That's a very tiny point, of course, but I think where these regulations are leaving such a broad discretion, which is ultimately a good thing in terms of allowing people in, that discretion should be gone through with a tooth comb to make sure that it isn't pushing people out.
Okay, Jules.
Very homeless specific point, but within the guidelines, it does allow for people to be moving from temporary accommodation into their own tenancies to access community care grants slightly ahead of time to avoid that kind of gap between the move taking place and so somebody's without goods. Though we would like to see that kind of really pushed a stage further where somebody is entering any temporary supported accommodation, then is allocated what they're going to be allocated at the end, or informed of what they're going to be allocated, be it furniture, packages, money, or whatever that they can expect, for that to almost to be able to be put to one side and part of their support and just signed off on the point of them moving into a tenancy, just to kind of stop there being that gap. Because one of the issues that we've seen within the new process, which I have to say is much better than it used to be years ago, but one of the issues is still that gap and time lag between somebody receiving the yes for a tenancy and then actually receiving the goods for them moving in, so they can still be having to lie on a floor for a few weeks until they actually receive the items. So just really guideline specific for that.
Okay. Bill?
Should we tackle points that Carly and John have made earlier about the route to and the process to making an application being on websites? Over half of disabled people have no internet access, and even if you gave them the internet access, a lot of disabled people wouldn't be able to use it. So it is making sure that guidance does actually say to councils, look, there has to be more than one route to making an application, because that recognises that people with different impairments might need different routes to be able to make that application. If you say it's telephone only and it's somebody with a communication impairment or a hearing impairment, they're not going to be able to use it. So it's having a variety of routes that people can genuinely access the fund when they need it, without additional barriers being put in their way. Very much that's the sort of stuff we would like to see in guidance. And I'd echo John on the payment provision. We do think there should be a requirement that there's evidence that you should make it in another form to cash, because we would hope that the applicant's preference is normally observed where it can be for their for the payment to be made in cash where they genuinely want that.
Okay. Norman, did you want to come in?
Thank you. Just very briefly, I think the guidance has to be consistent with regulations, and they have to be very closely aligned. Otherwise, it'll become somewhat disjointed. And I think if we end up using exceptional circumstances all the time, it means that there's something we haven't quite got right in terms of the discussion, and I think that's something that we do have to be mindful of, in terms of that guidance, that it does allow the flexibility, the flexibility that we spoke about, that everybody spoke about earlier on.
Okay. Earlier on, Morag, and I think Jacqui, you also referred to, you were talking about the profiling and how you manage the budgets and the assessments and the reporting. Is there an onerous bureaucracy or responsibility attached to it, or is it a fairly simple process?
So yeah, it's fairly simple from our perspective. Not every local authority uses the same recording system, but the system that we use, it's, you know, we can get reports out of it fairly easily.
Okay, Morag.
I think similarly, now that we're into our third year, I think we've refined the process as we've gone along, and I wouldn't say that the recording of information budget management is onerous.
Okay. Are there any aspects of the regulations or indeed the guidance which haven't been touched on, which any of the witnesses would want to comment on before we close? Jamie?
Just to echo the points around the need for case studies and the need for there's room within the guidance to have detailed case studies, for example, for a number of different groups, including refugees. But I think the main point that I would like to make in the terms of the guidance and in terms of the sort of standard application form, which is going forward as well, is that point around national insurance numbers and making it clearer to local authorities of the fact that applications can be taken without national insurance numbers. There's an additional kind of factor to this. I think the question about having applications refused because of national insurance numbers has historically been something that we've come across quite often. We've worked a lot with Glasgow City Council to make sure that doesn't happen. I think a lot of that has been to do with the application forms and the standard systems which are used by Scottish Welfare Funds going forward, which don't like it if you don't have a national insurance number. As we go forward with refugees, with the wider dispersal of refugees through the Syrian resettlement system, I think we're likely to see more refugee populations outside of the Glasgow area. In Glasgow, we have a workaround around how to deal with applications who don't have a national insurance number, but that certainly won't be obvious to councils across Scotland as we kind of go forward. So something clearer, something a little bit more, and if we can work on the application form to make it clear from the application form that there is no need for this, that there is a box for a national insurance number if you have it, that sort of thing.
Thanks. Anyone else? Any other comments, John?
Just on the regulation about reviews, there's a couple of points there. Firstly, that the methods of making a review application are subtly different for the first tier review to the second tier review, because you've got the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman setting their own procedure in relating to how you apply for a second tier review, and that's actually, in terms of the methods that can be used with these regulations, it's at the discretion of a local authority to accept a review request otherwise than in writing, whereas the SPSO's regulations actually do say something materially different, which I think is potentially confusing, and that the extension of the time limit to request a first tier review is at the discretion of the local authority, which to us it looks like if the local authority decides they're not going to exercise that discretion, that would seem to block access to the second tier review entirely, including consideration of whether it's reasonable to extend that discretion, leaving the only recourse as being judicial review, which doesn't seem ideal. And that's kind of analogous to the situation where somebody's refused a DWP benefit and makes a challenge outside a month, giving the decision maker discretion on whether you give someone access to an independent review seems to us to be disproportionate.
Okay, thanks. Did you want to come in, Carly?
Yes, please. This point is slightly linked to something that John mentioned earlier about the views of the applicant. In terms of the written decision that is provided to an applicant, we're really pleased to see that there's quite a substantial list of what should be included within that written decision. The one thing that we think potentially could be missing is clarification about ensuring that the views of the applicant is included within that written decision. Although it does say that the details of the application must be included, that doesn't necessarily suggest that the individual view of the applicant making the application would be included within the written decision. And we would argue that formal written recognition of an individual's view is paramount to them being able to uphold their rights and then to advocate for themselves if they do decide to take that to a review.
Okay, thanks. Morag, do you have any final suggestions? No. Jules? Thank you. Norman? Jacqui? Okay, well, listen, thank you very much. Not just for the written evidence, but for what we've heard this morning. It's been very constructive, thoughtful. Clearly, you're passionate about the work that you do, but also well-informed, and that is helpful. It's also been useful to hear that you're supportive of the regulations, and I suspect that the committee will be asking for the regulations to be approved, but we will try to reflect where we can some of what we've heard for the Scottish Government to consider in terms of the guidance. So thank you very much. Okay. And with that, we'll suspend the meeting and move into private session.